Hello, welcome to EPG Pathshala. Today we will cover the topic processing of hydrometer data under the module water resource and management. In this particular module we shall see how a hydrometer functions, that is the working of hydrometer. We shall see the basic characteristics of a hydrometer. Thereafter, we shall find out the specific gravity of the liquids using hydrometer and sediment analysis. In the end, we would do the calibration of hydrometer and see various methodologies used to calibrate this hydrometer. Hydrometer is a simple and economic tool to measure density of liquids. This is generally made up of glass and consists of cylindrical stem with bulb at its lower end. So, the lower half of the hydrometer has a bulb and the upper half has stem which are graduated. This bulb is weighed with mercury or lead, generally lead, to make it float straight. That means once you dip this hydrometer into water, it shall float, and the calibration on the stem gives you the reading that needs to be taken. So, once you dip the hydrometer inside the liquid whose specific gravity you want to measure, swirl it a little bit, then this hydrometer shall automatically float, and the value that you shall get to see on the surface of the water, the calibration value or the scale value, shall be the reading that you need to take. The hydrometer works on Archimedes' principle, which is known to all of us, which says that a soil suspended or a solid suspended in a fluid is buoyed by a force equal to the weight of the fluid displaced by the submerged part of the suspended solid. So that means if you are suspending a solid in a fluid, it would displace some amount of fluid which will be equal to the weight of the fluid that has been displaced by the submerged part of the suspended solid. So, higher the submergence, the higher the weight of the fluid displaced. For working of hydrometer, the liquid whose specific gravity is to be measured is poured into a cylindrical container, and the hydrometer is placed gently into the liquid in a way that it floats freely. So, you ideally take a graduated cylinder, somewhere around 1 liter of the liquid is taken whose specific gravity is to be measured, and thereafter you gently place this hydrometer into that liquid. If you exert a little bit of force, then since it is fragile, since it is made up of glass, there are chances that it might break. So, you have to be very, very careful while holding or while dealing with hydrometer. The point at which the surface of liquid touches the stem of the hydrometer is red. That means once you dip the hydrometer into the liquid, it will automatically float as I had explained earlier, and wherever that the value comes over, that is the reading that you need to measure, and this point corresponds to the specific gravity of the liquid. Now, you have two ranges of hydrometer which depends upon the density of the liquid. So, for low density liquids, something like, you know, kerosene, alcohol, gasoline, you have mark 1 near the top of the stem. While for high density liquids, which is brine, milk and acids, you have mark 1 near the bottom. So, individually depending upon whether you are using high density liquids or low density liquids, the mark needs to be either on the top of the stem or the bottom of the stem. The various scales of the hydrometer that are to be used depend totally upon the usage that it has. There is API gravity hydrometer, which is generally used in petroleum industry, bomb scale, which is used in industrial chemistry and pharmacology, brick scale, food processing industries, platter scale for brewing industries, twaddle scale for bleaching and dyeing industry. Then there are specialized hydrometers which are used over for specific purposes. For example, to find out the density of milk, lactometer is used, wherein The sample is divided into 100 fractions and then milk is dispensed into the instrument and allowed to stand till cream is formed. Based on the depth of the cream that is formed in degrees, conclusion is drawn on the quality of milk. And if lactometer floats on milk, it is pure. If not, adulterated. That means if it is able to come onto the surface of the milk, it is pure. Otherwise, if it dips down, then definitely it is adulterated. So, herein one important thing that we need to understand is that the temperature plays a very important role in the hydrometer calculations or the readings that we need to find out. So, all this procedure needs to be dispensed at a particular temperature. So, basically saccharometer is used to measure the quantity of sugar in a liquid. You must have seen that as the sugar content changes, the specific gravity or the density of the liquid also changes. So, depending upon the sugar content that is available in honey, would you see its specific gravity changing? Something of the same kind is used in saccharometer. This was invented by Thomas Thomson and is used mainly in wine making and brewing industries. It consists of a big bulb with slender stem rising from the top and has calibrated marking on it. As I told earlier, that this also works on principle of buoyancy. Sugar content can be determined by reading the value where the surface of the liquid crosses the scale. If bulb floats higher on the liquid, the sugar content is high, and if bulb flows lighter, naturally the sugar content is low, since the specific gravity of the liquid will be low and the density also will be low. The maximum usage of hydrometer is found in alcoholometer. That means it is measured to find the elevated levels of alcohol in spirit. This is also known as proof and trials hydrometer, which is used to find out the alcohol percentage in spirits. And this works very, very well in finding the percentage contents of alcohol. They have scales distinct with volumes, percents of potential alcohol based on a pre-calculated specific gravity. Again, not missing out the point that this has to be done at specific temperature. Hydrometer also finds usage in urinometer, that is clinical hydrometer, which is used for urine analysis. Depending upon the specific gravity of urine, you can find the ratio of solutes to water and thus can determine pathologically, you know, if the urine is contaminated. Coming over to the principles of hydrometer analysis, it is basically onto the Stokes' law, which states that velocity at which grain settles out of suspension with all other factors being equal is dependent upon the shape, weight and size of the particle. Thus relates the terminal velocity of a free falling sphere in a liquid to its diameter. The equation is given as V is equal to Gs minus Gw by 18 mu, this whole factor into d square. So that means terminal velocity V has Gs, which is the specific gravity of solids, specific gravity of liquid, which is dW, nu, which is viscosity of the liquid, and d, diameter of the sphere. The higher the diameter, the higher will be the terminal velocity, since V is directly proportional to d square. So, the higher the size or the dia of the sediment or the particle that you are taking into consideration, the higher shall be the terminal velocity. However, Stokes' law of course comes with its limitation, first being that you are talking of only firm spherical particles. When you are talking of Stokes' law, there has to be no interaction of particles with each other. That means there should be no association or dissociation happening between the particles. They should remain separated from each other, otherwise once they tend to associate or dissociate or clog, then Stokes' law doesn't hold valid. They have to be at least large enough, which is greater than 0.0002 mm, so that Brownian motion does not come into picture, and they should be smaller than 0.2 mm so that turbulence is not caused. Now, if they are greater than 0.2 mm, again because of turbulence, Stokes' law will not be valid. further smaller than 0.0002 mm, then Brownian motion will come into picture. How is hydrometer used for sediment analysis? Now, as I told earlier, that hydrometer is used for liquid analysis wherein graduated cylinder is taken, 1000 ml of the liquid that you are trying to analyze is taken, and thereafter hydrometer is dipped. In sediment analysis, it requires a little more extensive process, because here you are trying to find out the dia of the soil particles that are existing in the soil sample that you have taken. So, to do that, you have to have first a good amount of representative sample, which could be 50 grams of soil, which you can take from a larger size portion of say 500 grams. You have to pass around 50 grams of soil from sieve 200, which will result in passing of 75 micron size particles. So, this sieve 200 shall allow all the particles which are less than 75 micron size or equivalent, and you have to take around 50 grams of this soil sample. Mix it with 4% of slurry of sodium metaphosphate, that is, you have to form a slurry with this soil, with mixing it with sodium metaphosphate, which has to be around 125 ml. You could mix this using a mixer for 1 minute. How does sodium metaphosphate helps? As I told earlier, that Stokes law shall not be valid if association or dissociation is taking place, and that would happen if flocculation is taking place. So, this sodium metaphosphate prevents flocculation. This slurry so formed after the mixing for 1 minute is transferred to a graduated cylinder of around 1000 ml. The volume is made up taking care that no bubbles are formed. Now, why is it that bubbles should not be formed? Again, the validity of Stokes law comes into picture. If there would be bubbles within this graduated cylinder, then Stokes law shall not be holding true. Thereafter, once you've made up the volume to 1000 ml, immediately cover the graduated cylinder with a lid and turn it upside down for a minute, taking care of no spillage. Since you've already made it up to the mark, you have to ensure that there's no spillage of even 0.5, 0.25 ml, and you have to carefully turn it upside down for 1 minute. Then you have to start the timer as soon as the mixing is complete. Since time of settling down of the particle plays an important role in calculation of the diameter. So, the minute you keep down the graduated cylinder after mixing, that very same second you have to start noting the time and take these hydrometer readings at 15, 30, 60, 120, 240, 480 seconds. The principle on which the hydrometer analysis is there has been described into two equations, wherein in one we shall find the diameter of the sediment or the soil particles, and the other in which we will find percent finer. Now, percent finer is equal to K into HR by WS, the whole factor being multiplied with 100, where K is a constant, which is generally taken as 1. HR is the hydrometer reading that you are going to get. WS is the weight of the sample, which is 50 grams. For calculation of D, you have to have a constant K, whose value is 0.0133 for all practical purpose. L is the corrected length, and T is the time in minutes. What is this corrected length? How do you find out HR? We shall just see. Let us discuss the calculation that are involved in the calculation of dia of hydrometer. The first column that we have is of the time, that is, as I told you, the minute you keep down the graduated cylinder, you have to start measuring the time, which you have taken in the first column. 15, 30, 60 and 120 seconds. I haven't proceeded further with it because I just want to elaborate on to how these calculations shall be done over. Then the second column is hydrometer reading that you are going to get, which is denoted by HR. So at 15 seconds, the graduation that was there of hydrometer at the surface of the liquid was 41. So hydrometer reading at 15 seconds was 41, at 30 was 35, at 60 was 31, and 120 was 28. As you can see, with increase of time, the hydrometer reading is going down. The percent finer that we have calculated, as I told earlier, is K, which is 1 into HR by WS into 100. So basically, this is 41 divided by conversion of time into minutes. That means initially you will have to convert this 15 seconds into minutes. So 15 by 60. Then this HR needs to be divided by WS, which is the weight of the sample. HR is 41, weight of the sample is 50. So 41 divided by 50 into 100 is 82. So hydrometer reading is HR 41, sample weight is 50, 41 by 50 into 100 is 82. Corrected length column that you're going to obtain shall be from the table that has been given hereafter in the next slide. It has also been depicted as table 1 in the module. Here, if you would see, the hydrometer reading is giving you a parallel value, a corresponding value of L. At hydrometer reading 41, you would see in table that the L value is 9.6. This is how I made another column of corrected length. Parallelly for 35, the value of L shall be 10.6, so on and so forth. So you found the corrected length. As I told you, K is a constant. D is the diameter of the particle that you need to find out now. And as I told you earlier, herein the calculation that you have to do is K into root L by T, where T that you'll have to take has to be in minutes. So since we've taken the results in seconds, we need to convert it over to minutes. That means 15 by 60 seconds shall convert the time into minutes. L shall be this corrected length that you have found, and time in minutes shall be conversion of the time that you've got in minutes. So your D shall be 9.6 divided by 15 by 60. And then you have to take root of that into 0.0133. As a result, you shall get the value of 0.0824. And you would notice here that as the time increases, the dia keeps on decreasing. To get the final grain size distribution curve, you have to plot percent finer on vertical axis and grain size on horizontal axis. This has to be done on a log scale, and this curve is called as grain distribution curve, which can further be used to get the soil characteristics. Now, coming over to various methodologies of calibration of hydrometer, there are three primary methods for calibrating hydrometers. First is direct comparison method, in which this is the simplest mode to check hydrometers by mean of diverse standard liquid with known density. This generally is done with standard water first. So initially, standard water in which the sample is being repeated is being prepared. That means if you're talking of alcohol industry, then the basic standard water which is being used over to further do the brewing is checked for the temperature at 20 degrees centigrade. Ideally, the specific gravity reading should be 1, that is, at 20 degrees centigrade, the specific gravity that you should get through hydrometer should be 1. Reading taken for reference and then subtracted from sample specific gravity. So, if there is reference specific gravity of 1.004, with that I mean that if you take the standard water in which sample is being prepared, you dip it into the graduated cylinder, which is just having this sample, which is just having this particular standard, sorry. Then, if you are ideally speaking, you should get a reading of 1.000 at 20 degrees centigrade. You are getting a reference specific gravity of 1.004. Thereafter, you take a sample, you fill it up in graduated cylinder, and you see the reading. The reading, let's say, comes over to 1.044. Then the actual sample value, specific gravity of the sample shall be 1.044 minus 0.004 coming from the calibration that you have obtained by using standard water, since ideally it should have given 1.000, but it gave 1.004, so there is a difference of 0.004 that you have obtained. Thus, in this case, to get the sample value, you will have to take 1.044 minus 0.004, so eventually you shall get 1.040. However, the main drawback is that you need to have specific reference liquid with appropriate density in order to cover the whole liquid density range. Sometimes just taking water does not do. The other method that is generally used for the calibration of hydrometer is the ring method, which works on the principle of constant volume hydrometers. Herein, the hydrometer is allowed to float in a single liquid with known density by loading the top of its stem with weights. So, what you are doing is, you continuously keep adding the weights onto the stem of the hydrometer and see how much of graduation change occurs because of the weight sinking. Since you are adding weight, the weight would sink the hydrometer to the specific graduation, to the specified graduation, and thereby calibration shall be performed. So, you can keep adding these weights in the form of rings to the hydrometer to calibrate it. The number and weight of the rings and the feature of the buoyant liquid have somehow, however, limited the application of this method, because it is very cumbersome to use these rings and they calibrate them first with the weights and then seeing the buoyant liquid that has moved over. The final calibration method that we are going to discuss shall be hydrostatic weighing method, which was introduced by Cuckoo in 1949. This requires hydrostatic weighing, wherein you use a balance to measure the apparent mass of the hydrometer while it is immersed to several levels in a single liquid of known density. So, what you have done here is, instead of taking rings, you straight away attach the hydrostatic weight to the hydrometer. Initially, the buoyant force is calculated in air, and thereafter the hydrometer is sunk into reference liquid using weights being added on the balance. So, since you have connected a balance to the hydrometer, straight away you can keep putting weights into the balance and see how much change in the value in the readings of hydrometer is occurring. So, you do away with the ring weights that were causing a problem in the earlier calibration method, and you get direct hydrostatic weighing. I have given a diagram of the hydrostatic weighing, wherein you can see the balance being directly connected to the hydrometer, and you can keep adding weight to the balance so that the hydrometer keeps depending upon the weight that you have added. Advantages of this method is that it eliminates the inconvenience of storing a collection of liquids, permits the calibration of hydrometer at specified scale marks without the inconvenience of preparing liquid mixtures to specified densities, and thus this can be automated more easily as compared to other hydrometers. So, coming over to the summary of this particular module, we did the processing of hydrometer data, so wherein we discussed what hydrometer is all about. What are the various characteristics? How does it function? Thereafter, we talked of the various laws which govern the hydrometer functioning, and then we found the specific gravity of liquids using hydrometer. Later on, we discussed the specific gravity calculation of the soil in sediments and the diameter of the soil particles using hydrometer. And finally, we discussed about the three methods of calibrating the hydrometer. This would end this particular lecture. Thank you.